Yeah, good afternoon to all. Just for 2 minutes, I'm just uploading this day one zip once again. So in the meantime, the other participants can join the session. So kindly check once again, are you able to access it or not? Please let me know. Maybe by the end of the session, you can inform me. So this session is basically focusing on the smart sensing systems towards the Internet of Things. So how do we try to design and develop a sensing system, more specifically a smart sensing system, that is the intelligent sensing systems for our Internet of Things applications and for various purposes? So this outline of the session is we start with basics of our electronics. We start with what is called as an electronic signal. Then the important equations, which are basically on the electricity phenomena or philosophy, which are mostly requiring for our Internet of Things applications. So people who are interested in connecting various devices, various sensors, and so on and so forth, these equations are the basic things. So you should not forget these things, and you should be having much clarity on how these equations functions and so on and so forth. So I would like to dwell upon a little bit on these electricity equations. Then we'll see what are called general purpose input-output pins, the functions which are already present in various boards, and how our analog to digital converters are helping us in transforming our analog signal to digital, and what are the parameters required that you need to consider and as well as look into when you are trying to interface or instrument various other electronic devices. Of course, at the end of the session, we'll try to look for the microcontrollers and the computers, what are the functionalities available, and what are the various sensors, peripherals, and some of the case studies, or in the sense that the one which I have designed and developed various smart sensing systems. I will put forward the details to you with the photographs and so on and so forth. So this session is somewhat a little bit boring, but don't think, because a non-electronics or instrumentation guy feels a little bit boring. So I request and urge all those people not to get bored. Try to put more efforts here in trying to understand this stuff. So let me start here. Electronic signals. So basically, we have two different types of electronic signals. One is the analog signal and the other is digital. So basically, in our day-to-day life, whatever the things or the electronic gadgets that we use, basically all will be converted from analog to digital. In very simple terms, so whatever we are speaking or whatever we are trying to transmit, transmit in the sense that not through the electronic devices, but through a different means that you transmit orally from one person to another person. Or if you're using a mobile phone, everybody nowadays uses a mobile phone when you're speaking. By using a mobile phone, whatever you're talking, your sound waves are basically your analog waves. So your mobile phone, internally, it has got a conversion from analog to digital. So your voice, which is in analog form, is converted to your digital form. So the digital form data, of course, the digital here is a binary digits. If you're looking for the quantum, of course, this is a new trend which is going to, it's already been evolved. So later this philosophy is going to be changed a little bit in the coming years. So as of now, I'm talking about the binary digits itself, that is using ones and zeros. So your analog signal, whatever you talk with the help of your mobile phone, is converted to the digital in the form of ones and zeros. And you're transmitting those ones and zeros, the digital form of data, to the other side or to the other entity. And at the other entity, the reverse process takes place, converting from digital to analog, and you are going to hear the voice of the another person. So basically, we all make use of these analog to digital or digital to analog. So very frequently, if you are trying to involve anything with your hardware devices, we make use of these signals very much in our day-to-day life. So what we do here is we can only store digital signals. If you are trying to use any electronic device, so those electronic devices for transmission, for storage purposes, usually those devices store the data using either one or several bits per sample. Yes, sample means a data which has been collected from a particular instance of time. So these bits of data, either you can store it in terms of arrays of numbers, or you can just simply store in terms of bits itself. So the two important parameters for the digital signal, if you see here, very much, of course, as far as Internet of Things, there are other parameters too, but the basic things which are required anybody to understand here is two important parameters. One is on the bits per sample, and the other is on the sampling rate. So the sampling rate, basically, it gives the rate at which you are trying to transmit the samples, either from one end to another or from the another end to yours or whatever it may be, vice versa. We can call it as a frequency at which your samples are being transmitted. So a sample here is a particular quantity of information at a particular instance of time that you have collected from your analog signal to your digital. So how many bits are you going to use or represent that particular collected sample is what people have to understand here. How many bits? You can use a one bit to store a one bit of information, or you can use several bits to store a certain set of sampled information. So if you're using a one bit just to store a particular information, that bit values can be either zero or one. That's what your binary digits, the digital logic, do specify. So the zero is to be considered as a low and one is to be considered as a high value. So here, that zero or one can be a digital value, basically a one bit signal sample. So if you are going to use n bits signals sample, then obviously your values are going to range from zero to 2^(n-1). So that is basically you are transformed your analog signal to your digital signal, and you are representing the digital signal on your electronic device in terms of bits of zeros and ones. So those bits of zeros and ones usually represent the outside world's or the real world's analog values. Now, the important thing here is the sampling rate. So what should be the optimal rate, or what should be the rate at which you need to sample the signals or to consider for transmission purpose or for transforming to analog to digital? All this, all, of course, the sampling rate has its own set of functionalities. Everybody should understand. So when you are converting your analog to digital form, the one thing that you have to consider is basically that your analog to digital converter or your microcontroller, which you are using, which consists of analog to digital conversion functionality, you have to make sure that the faster we sample, the higher the accuracy. So if you look into the diagram on the upper side of the figure, if you have an input signal, and your sampling rate is given, if the sampling rate is taking place at different instances of time, and if you see at the later part of that figure, the sampling rate is very fast. So this, when the sampling rate is very fast, the below diagram, which indicates the restoration or the signal which has been already been, which is very much similar to your input. If your sampling rate is not very fast or not appropriate or not proper, then obviously the signal that has been constructed, the digital signal that is in the form of output, is not very much similar to the input signal. So according to the Nyquist theorem, the sampling frequency should be greater than or equal to twice the maximum frequency. That is what the fundamental principle. And most of the ADC converters do takes place, and this is the rate at which the data analog to digital conversion should take place. If you are not following a particular this Nyquist theorem, or you are not following an appropriate rate at which the sample should be there, then the example will be something like, sometimes when you hear from the mobile phone, the voices of the other person is not clear. Sometimes distortions, sometimes breakups, or sometimes a male to female voice or some other baby voice. You might have already experienced this kind of stuff. It means basically all those problems is nothing but your analog to digital conversions are not taking place at the maximum or at the most appropriate times. So that is the reason at which why you are having some breakups in during your telephonic conversations, or of course it can be the communication or the network issues too. But more or less, if the voice has been changed to another person's voice, is basically is related to your, the sampling rate is not proper for the analog to digital conversion which has taken place. So the fundamentally, the sampling frequency, the sampling rate should be greater than or equal to twice the maximum frequency that needs to be considered in converting A to D or analog to digital. Now, another fundamental equations as far as the Internet of Things systems need to be designed and developed. People, when they try to connect the electronics or the other sensor devices, the most important equations, very, very most important, one is on the Ohm's law and another is on the Kirchhoff's law, Kirchhoff's law one and law two. So if you see the first equation, we, of course, some people write V is equal to IR or U is equal to IR. Basically, your Ohm's law, the voltage resistance and the current relationship with each other. Everybody needs to understand this basic equations very clearly. V is equal to IR is about the Ohm's law is stating. Of course, everybody knows this. And of course, the other two laws are the Kirchhoff's first law. Some of the currents in that particular branch of the circuit or in the loops of the circuits, some of the currents is always going to be zero. And the energy that is going to be generated or the energy that is going to be produced or the consumed is always going to be proportional to the resistance and the current which has been passing on that particular circuit or the design of the circuit which you are going to develop and make use of. So these laws or these equations are the most important equations that everybody needs to understand here. So let me just quickly recap and to make you to understand or to just to refresh yourself. So the Ohm's law states that if you have a circuit like this, or the one which you have shown in the figure, and of course this is just a generic circuit. Here we have a 3 volts power supply which is acting like a battery. A plus is on one side and minus is on the side. That is your with respect to the cathodes and anodes. And you connected that particular circuit with 3 resistors. Of course, the purpose of a resistor is to resist the flow of current that is being in that particular diagram. So resistors are going to be very much widely used in the Internet of Things designing of applications. So everybody needs to understand what is a resistor is. So the purpose of a resistor is basically to resist the flow of current or the rate of current flow in that particular circuit. So why 3 resistors? Of course, you are going to make that particular flow of current in a particular way. Of course, this is just a diagram for you to understand here. So these 3 resistors are connected in the series. So according to Ohm's law, the current flowing will be is equal to what is the current flowing in that particular circuit is 3 volts by the sum of the resistors which are connected in the series. Of course, never you should talk in terms of amperes. If you are talking in terms of amperes for Internet of Things applications, for most of the cases, if you're talking or if you're getting something on amperes, it means something is wrong at your design or something is wrong at your philosophy. So basically your idea is wrong. Usually Internet of Things applications, most of the devices, your currents will be in terms of milliamperes. Please do remember this. So you need to, even if you have the amperes values which are obtaining, because basically you have a volt and the resistors in the ohms, you'll get an amperes, but do specify in terms of milliamps. the rate at which you are going to have that current flow along with the resistance values, you get the corresponding current value. So this is how your Ohm's law is helping us to monitor the resistance as well as the voltage values and the current flow across that particular circuits. So if at all two values are known, you can find out the third value. That's what we all know from this equation. Once you are clear with the equation, you can get, if you are having the current and the voltage values, then you can find out what can be the resistor value. So similarly, if you have two known values, you can find out the third value. That's what you can see it in the other diagrams too. Now coming to the Kirchhoff's law 1 and law 2. So if you see the upper figure, it has got two loops here. Of course, you can call it as two branches. So basically, there is a branch L1 and there is a branch L2, or a loop 1 L1 and a loop L2. So I took this particular basic figures, make you to just to recap. So just try to understand here. So the current flowing in one direction, the positives, those values will be, I values will be positive, which is going to the outside world. So from your plus, it is going I2 and I3 are outside to this. So this will be plus values and the current coming inside. Of course, the people have followed this nomenclature. It can be the either way also. Only thing is it will be in a negative value. But usually the common philosophy, the scientific world consider is the ones which are going outside is to be considered as plus, and the current which is coming towards in is basically considered as your negative value. So the sum of the currents in that particular entire circuit will be obviously will be zero. So that's the Kirchhoff's law 1. Coming to Kirchhoff's law 2. So here on the loop 1, you have an energy E, that is a battery, that voltage, how much you are giving, which is equivalent to IR1 plus IR3. So the voltage is across the resistor 1 plus the voltage across the resistor 3. That gives you IR1 plus IR1 plus IR3. Of course, here high is I1 here, and the other with respect to R3 is the I3. So the sum of this is going to be the total voltage of the total battery for this one. Whereas for the loop 2, you don't have a battery source, you don't have a power source, you don't have a voltage here. So, but the value will be something to I2 R2 minus I3 R3, because I3 is going outside. So that I value is negative here. So with this recap, that is sufficient to have the electricity equations. And one more equation is very much required when you're connecting sensors, when you are connecting various devices, is what is called as voltage divider. The meaning of voltage divider is nothing but, of course, it is a split of voltage. You are going to split the voltage which is flowing across that particular circuit. So if you just hide V out, what has happened is the V in is the source of voltage which is coming here, and it is directly connected to the ground with the help of two resistors in between. So please, I am urging all of you, please understand the voltage divider, which is very much required for our IoTs. Why? Because until unless you don't understand or you don't know this, you definitely are going to fire your boards. Because this voltage divider is one particular fundamental thing which will always help you to make sure your boards, your devices are not fired and they are working properly. So here, what we are trying to do is the voltage source which is connected to the ground with the help of two resistors which are connected in series. But what is that you are going to measure is, you are going to measure. Measure means the amount of voltage in between this R1 and R2. So the purpose here is your sensor, you can replace any one of these resistors and you can put your sensors. And by that way, you can measure what is the output of that particular sensor using your Vouts. So that is the basic idea behind to have an understanding on the voltage divider. So this particular voltage divider helps you to find out what resistors you need to connect to your sensor so that the sensors will not burn, will not damage to your circuit, or will not damage to your systems and all. So here, of course, the sum of these voltages across these resistors R1 and R2 is going to be what is the actual voltage which has been flowing from your Vin. So if you look here carefully, the voltage across the resistor R1 is equal to I times R1 plus R2, because R1 plus R2 is what the total resistors which are connected into your Vin. So you have I which is the small I, which is flowing in, which is flowing inside to this particular direction. The I value which is coming into this direction from R1 to R2 towards your ground. So the I is the small I. Small I is the current which is flowing across these two resistors. So the voltage on the upper side of this R1 resistor basically is nothing but here we have I according to Ohm's law, I times R1 plus R2. Similarly, the voltage across this R2, when you come to the bottom of this particular screen, or is equal to IR2. So basically, the small I is the current which is the same on the two halves. Half one, the first half, and the second half is also I value only, small I. So both equations are to be equated. So when you equate the, both the I values, basically you get the value of V out. So V out is equal to, you have V in multiplied by R2 divided by, whole divided by R1 plus R2. So this is the equation for the voltage divider. Please make a note of this one. V out is equal to V in times R2 by R1 plus R2. This equation will always help you what resistor values you need to put for various sensors which are getting connected to your circuits. So now the question comes, if you understood the equation of the voltage divider, where V out, basically through V out only you measure what is the output of the sensors. So usually, if you have seen different sensors, sensors will have different legs. So two leg sensors, three leg sensors, four leg sensors. So a sensor with two legs, it means that that sensor is not having the voltage divider. A sensor with three legs, it means that the voltage divider is already present in that sensor. So you need not take care of the voltage divider equation. Please remember this. Sensor with three legs and four legs and so on and so forth. So most of the sensors will have, if they're having three legs means one leg will for VCC connecting to the voltage source, one leg for your ground, and one leg to measure the output from that particular sensor. Those are the three pins. So if there are three pins, means most likely the voltage divider is already present in that sensor circuit. If there are only two pins, like your LEDs, they are basically your diodes. So don't have the voltage dividers. That's why a resistor has to be connected to an LED, because otherwise the LED gets burned, or if you are going to connect directly to the board, your board also is going to be fried. So usually sensors or any electronic devices with two legs or two pins, though they will not have the voltage divider functionality. So you have to make sure what type of resistor, how much quantity of resistor has to be put together. So that is the main purpose of having the voltage divider. So now coming to, just to have a clarity here, to have a little bit further clarity. So voltage divider, once again, I repeat, V out is equal to V in times R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So if at all R1 is zero, the resistor value is zero here, zero ohms. The R1 value is zero. So what about the V out value? What can be the V out value? So if you apply simply the R1 is zero into our equation, V out is equal to R2 divided V in into R2 divided by R1 plus R2, R1 is zero, R2, R2 cancels. So your V out is almost equivalent to your, whatever the voltage you have given. So V in is equal to V out. So there is no, almost equal. So there's no loss of your voltage here, even if your R1 is equal to zero. So one more important information I'd like to share at this point. Usually V out is what a measurement which you do it. A measurement means what is the output you are getting. So that's why you call it as out here. Suppose, how do you measure a voltage? Of course, people cannot respond to me interactively here. Just I like to give the answer for you. Usually, the measurement of voltages are done with your voltmeters or your multimeters. So whenever you use a certain kind of devices, the voltmeters and the multimeters. So here, the voltmeters or the multimeters will have a high resistance. Whenever there is a high resistance, there won't be a current. And when there is no current, there is no harm for you to measure how much the value is there. That's why you, when you put a voltmeter or a multimeter, your multimeter doesn't burn. Of course, it can show you a value. It means the current is not flowing. Current is not flowing means basically your resistance is very high. So usually that is one tendency, that is one philosophy you need to look here. So they're coming to the next one. If at all R2 is zero, so if the R2 is zero, your numerator is zero. If your numerator is zero, obviously your Vout is also zero. So just keep in mind the equation Vout is equal to Vin times R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Very straightforward equation. So based on that, you can try to get here. So when R2 is equal to infinite, it means a very high resistance, well, infinite resistance in simple terms. Very, very high resistance, infinite resistance. So when you put in infinite resistance for your R2, obviously your R2, which has been grounded here, is an infinite resistance. Your Vout is almost equivalent to your Vin, which is get, of course, the resistor is going to contain or you resist certain only current values a little bit and is almost equivalent here. Coming to the another equation, if your R1 is equal to 0, R2 is equal to 0, what happens? The both the resistance are zeros. It means basically R2 is 0 means you are just putting a cable there, that's all. Your Vin is equal to Vout. We are putting, you are just having a connection without resistors. It's just like connecting through a cable, that's all. Please remember, if you are just directly connecting through a cable and you are passing certain voltages through that particular cable, it means, and that is connected to a ground, is nothing but basically a short circuit. So is a, never ever do like this without resistors. You don't connect, please do not connect your sensors and other components together. Make sure you study the circuit, the schematics of those. So most likely the 3-pin sensors or 4-pin sensors, the manufacturers, they'll take care of the voltage divider functionality in that sensors itself, sensors or actuators or electronic components. So if at all, if there are only 2 pins, one anode and cathode only, definitely you should take care of having a resistor value. Please do remember these fundamental things. Of course, everybody, faculty, they know it, but anyway, just I'm just recapping this for our Internet of Things fundamentals here. Okay, now coming to the general purpose input and output. So what is this general purpose in GPIO? In short, we call it as. So we have the boards which you have seen in the last session. I have shown you certain Arduino boards, Raspberry Pis, Intel Galileo, Intel Edison, okay, UDO, Parallel. So like this, all these boards, of course, because of the open source hardware, different people have manufactured different set of boards and provided different set of functionalities. So I will come one by one with a little introduction about these boards and why this is going to be important for us in our Internet of Things. So in our general purpose input and output, basically we have certain pins which looks outside, which the board is given to us. You can see the pins which are there on the diagram. So those are called basically your GPIO, general purpose. General purpose. Of course, some pins are multiplexed. It means some pins can be used for different purposes. So some pins can be used for pulse width modulation, PWM. So some pins can be used for controlling the other devices, and so on and so forth. Some pins are ground pins only. Ground means there is no voltage at that particular pin. That pin is only meant for connecting to the ground, in the sense that it is meant for your completing the circuit. So no voltage flows across that particular pin. So these general purpose I/O pins, basically the pins can act differently. A particular pin can act like a battery, it can be an output, or a particular pin can be acting like an input also. It means it is acting like a voltage meter. It means you can make use of a particular pin as an output for your application, or you can make use of a particular pin as an input at certain instances of your application. So depending on your application realization, you can make use of those pins in your connect using your schematics as an output pins or as an input pins. Input means you are going to give certain inputs, means your sensors may be connected to this particular pin, or you are going to collect some information from a particular pin. When you are having a particular schematic, you can collect that output by measuring certain things here. So a particular pin can be used either way for different purposes. Now, if you see the outputs of that particular pins, something like a Raspberry Pi, those output pins can be acting like a battery. So the output can be having a value of zero, which is basically we categorize as a low value. And a particular pin can act like a high value, with a high value of having either 5 volts as an output, or 3.3 volts as an output, or 1.8 volts as an output. So here, please remember, this 5 volts corresponds to Arduino boards, 3.3 volts corresponds to Raspberry Pi, and 1.8 corresponds to Intel Edisons and other set of devices. So usually in our Internet of Things, these gateways or these processing units, the pins of those particular processing units function with different variations of volts. So usually the Raspberry Pi is functioning with 3.3 volts. Your Arduino board can function 5 volts as well as with 3.3. Even further low, you can have certain pins of Intel Edisons and other stuff can have 1.8 volt only. So that is what at which your electronic components are functioning. So this is the advancements in hardware technology has made us to use those particular components at 1.8 volts levels itself. That is the advancements you see here. But most of the things, see this 1.8, since last decade I'm seeing, but of course they have their own limitations and all, they're commercially not that much viable to use it for different IoT applications. But most of the things, our electronic components and sensors, they are using at 5 volts and 3.3 volts. So people, when they're purchasing the things, you need to make sure at what levels they are, what voltages and so on and so forth. So let us see one example, small example. If you're connecting an LED over here, so if you see the cathode, that is a negative sign, is connected to a black color symbol on a pin, which is a ground, one of the pins of the Raspberry Pi. So this one, it means that black colors. So some of the pins on the Raspberry Pis are just a ground pins, which means that there is no flow of voltage. There's no current goes into that particular pin or comes out of that particular pin. So you just make use of those pins to connect various other sensors or other electronic components to that particular pin as a ground pin. These need to be, cathodes can be easily connected to that particular sets of pins. So similarly, if you see the other side, the anode of that particular LED is connected to a particular another pin here. Of course, it is in the green color here, pin number 40, or you can call it as a GPIO pin. So here, the GPIO pin here, please make an understanding here. This is the flow of current here. Please remember the ground is here. There is no flow of current here. So when there is no flow of current, only when there is a flow of current here, so there is a variations of current flow here. So when the LED receives the rate of current flow after a certain threshold, usually 0.6 volts, the LED is going to glow forever, something like that, or a point less than 0.6, it is not going to glow if you have a certain kind of threshold for that LED. So based on that, crossing the threshold value of rate of flow and as well as the pressure, that is the voltage value you give it, the LED glows here. But interestingly, you see there is a resistor connected to your LED. There's no, I told you, see this kind of two pins devices do not have voltage dividers. Definitely when there is no voltage dividers, then you are going to fire it. So as a thumb rule, you can make an understanding, whenever you connect an LED, you always connect an LED with your resistor. Now, coming to a resistor, what type of resistor? Resistors are again of different types. You do not worry about this. Is your thin flame coppers and your metallic frames. So different types of resistors are available, but most likely the commercially for your academic purpose, for your testing purposes and all, you have widely used a set of filament resistors. Of course, the quantity or the resistance value, how much you need to specify, is the most important thing here. So of course, if you calculate here, if you are giving a 3.3 volts for your Raspberry Pi and 1.8 volts has been consumed by your LED. So basically 1.8 has been consumed from 3.3, the remaining volts. And if you have a current flow of something like 0.025 amps or your 0.25 milliamps of current is flowing in this LED, usually you come up with a resistance value of 110 or 120, something like this. But here I am showing a figure, it is 220 homes. Usually, what happens is in the market, you will find the resistor values in terms of hundreds, 220 homes, 500, thousands, 10K, like this it goes on. So it is not that whatever the resistor value you want it based on your calculation, the resistor is not going to be available. So you need to look for a higher level of that resistor value so that your LED doesn't burn here. So that is what actually, the actual value is not 220 ohms resistor is required here actually. But in practice, because the availability of resistors comes in different blocks of sizes in terms of different ranges. So commercially you will get in terms of 100. After 100, you will get directly 220 only. So anything, if a resistor value in between is required, you can correct a 220 ohms resistor. So that, of course, the exact current will be a little bit minimized here, but that nevertheless, if at all a 0.6 volts above is there, your LED is going to glow. It will be in high value only. So there is no loss here. So this is one point you need to understand here. So another important point I would like to say is, it is not that always you connect a particular cathode to a ground pin of your Raspberry Pi or your to Arduino. You can as well connect your cathode to another GPIO pin. Let us assume that you connected this cathode to, instead of a ground pin, you connected to a GPIO 7 pin. Assume that. Do you, whether the LED will function or not? Yes, logically yes, and as well as practically yes. Provided the amount of information that you give it to GPIO 7, yes. Is basically you need to, instead of giving the, if you give a 0 volts, that is your 0 volts means a digital value 0 here, obviously the amount of flow current flowing from the already connected anode is sufficient enough for that LED to glow. If you are not making this particular GPIO to be 0 or 0 value is not passed on, that definitely that value will be high here, and both the high values will be there here on both the lines. And definitely that LED is not going to function. So it is logically what you need to understand is there should be a flow of current. The circuit should be completed. Whenever there is a flow of ions or flow of cathodes, will enable you to make the flow of ions in that particular circuits to glow that particular LED. So it need not be a ground pin, but if you want to, there is no provision in certain cases, you can make use of another pin also. And the functionality has to be changed. Instead of high value, you need to make it to 0 value, and you can make use of this. So like this, there are so many, when you do the practice, you will come to know all this kind of stuff. Just at this point, I just given a small indications to here. So here, the purpose of the voltage divider is the important thing that everybody needs to understand here once again. So we use the Vout. Vout is the most important thing where from this Vout only we measure it. This Vout becomes the input for the pin of the Raspberry Pi. Please remember, the Vout is what you get it from a sensor. If a sensor is already having the voltage divider in that particular circuit, the Vout is the output that manufacturer will give you, which particular pin is the output pin. So that Vout pin is going to be connected to your Raspberry Pi pin. So that means the you are going to measure the output of that particular sensor. So that output of the sensor is going to be the, it goes into the pin of that particular Raspberry Pi or your Arduino. So now basically to come back to that analog to digital converters, these analog to digital converters, basically if you want to process those signals or if you want to process the information that you collected through your sensors, so that processing is always viable, always feasible, always accurate and more robust only through your digital converters, means digital values. So until unless you don't convert your analog to digital, you cannot do the data processing efficiently on the digital equipments, on the digital processings. So here, that's why we always measure the voltages. So your the parameters, two important parameters already mentioned, bits per sample, how many bits are required to represent a particular sample, and how many such samples are to be sent at a particular instance of time or a particular duration of time. So that is the two parameters which will always help us for you to collect the data more efficiently. So for this one, we use a GPIO pin. So the GPIO pin of your Raspberry Pi, if you are going to just make use of only one bit, then obviously you are going to have either 0 or 1. So that one bit will tell you whether it is a low value or a high value. So that variations of low or high will happen only when there is certain threshold value which is passed on. So when above a threshold value, obviously it is going to be considered as a high, and below a threshold value, it is always considered to be a zero. So depending on the 5 volts of your Arduino, or depending on the 3.3 volts of your Raspberry Pi, your high and low values in terms of zeros and ones are going to be collected onto your processing unit. If you have n bits, then obviously your n bits are going to be representing a particular sample. You have a range of values from 0 to 2 power small n minus 1. So that many set of values are going to be used here. Basically, your Arduino uses 10-bit ADC conversions. So when it uses 10-bit ADC conversions, that is your 2 to power 10 minus 1. So 0 to 1023, that is the set of values that you get it from a ADC values of your Arduino. 0 to 1023, that is what totally you have 1024 values. So including 0, you had it. So 0 to 1023. So your ADC conversions, if you are using a 10-bit ADC conversion with your Arduino. So your values or your analog values are represented among this particular 0 to 1023 among this set of values. Now, if you look to the Edison, Intel Edison board, if you are using this Intel Edison board, if you see, there is one ADC available here. So only one ADC, of course, but you have A0 to A6, 7 pins, you can use it. Which are going to be used for your collecting the analog values. And these analog values are going to be converted to your digital values. But you have only one ADC, please remember. But you have 6 to 7 pins, which can be made use of an analog to digital conversions. So how this Intel Edison does is, basically, with only one ADC, whenever you have a bit of information coming to a bit, the pin A0 on this Edison, so obviously this is particularly A0 is going to convert here. In the sense, A0 analog is converted to digital. If at all you have a parallelly or one after the other, you have other analog values which are coming to the pins A1, A2, and so on and so forth. And basically these are all multiplexed. Remember, they all are going to be converted with the only one ADC only. So all these 6 pins, the conversion will take place, or conversion will be completed when all the 6 pins are been converted. In other terms, a little bit time consuming takes place. Why? Because you have only one ADC and you have analog data coming to all the 6 pins, and all 6 pins, each pin analog value has to be converted to digital. And that is to be done only by this one ADC only for all those pins. It will take some time. So it is little slow. In a sense, the real-time applications, when you play with the Edisons, you need to be careful here. Such kind of boards will have certain latencies in getting the digital values, converting from analog to digital. So depending on your applications, you can prefer what type of boards you like to have it, and what type of how much samples you need to convert, and how the things need to be handled. So if you look to the microcontrollers and the computers that you are using in our IoT sets of applications, so your Arduino boards are very simple systems, because the only program that you write is the firmware, and it can directly control your hardware. That is the advantage of your Arduino board. Of course, the speeds are a little bit slow. It has less capability. So you have only 2 KB and around 22 KB of programmable memory. So of course, now today what happened is, even the Google, the TensorFlow Lite programs, which you can run it on this, can also be stored on this less KBs. So we'll see that particular stuff in the tomorrow session of computer vision programming. So just have an idea here. What I mean to say is, today's artificial intelligence methods and techniques are also capable enough to incorporate those machine learning and artificial intelligence techniques on the less KBs microcontrollers too. So you can deploy your artificial intelligence techniques on the device itself directly. So that will enhance your performances. That's what the research and the products are coming in today's day-to-day life. So these microcontrollers have the GPIOs, yes, certainly, and general purpose input-output, you can see analog as well as digital, as well as the pulse width modulation. Yeah, pulse width modulation, basically, you have certain pins which you can control the signal. So the duty cycle of that signal, you can control it, whether you can have 25%, 50%, 75%, depending on your application requirements, how your analog signal has to be controlled, how your analog signal has to be converted to your digital form, how much signal is to be converted. You can control them using your pulse width modulation. And there are certain specific pins on there in the Arduino board. That is the advantage. Whereas in Raspberry Pi, you don't have pulse width modulation pins. You have a software. The software will take care of this pulse width modulation. Of course, it is not reliable and it is very consuming and time processing. That's why the Arduino boards are very advantageous here in this case. Similarly, ADCs, analog to digital converters, the Arduino boards are very much friendly, very much flexible, and they are robust, and they are very accurate, and they are very fast enough. Whereas your other mini computers like Raspberry Pis, you don't have ADCs, conversions, and so on and so forth. So one another difference you find here is run single software. The software is nothing but the program which you have written in the C programming. The C program is the only program which you embed. That's why embedded systems usually prefer for your Arduinos. Not only Arduinos, of course, Texas Instruments, MSP430 also can be preferred depending on the microcontrollers you use it. And the entire system can run in a real time and in parallel. And you can perform, you can control the hardware very easily. Whereas the mini computers like Raspberry Pis, it has its own operating system too. So the operating system, the Raspbian or your the older version is Jesse and other things. So they'll take their own time to process the data and to manage and control the devices here. So operating system, so the real-time applications cannot be done. So ideally what we do is we take both the things. So the microcontrollers and the mini computers together, we take the combination of these two things with the firmwares and the softwares, we can try to realize and build up beautiful applications which are related for your IoT, which even can run on the near real time. So usually Arduinos works with the nanoseconds, that is the rate the functionalities do, whereas Raspberry Pi is another works with the milliseconds. So if you can combine them, you can cascade them, you can integrate your microcontrollers with Raspberry Pis. There are various ways. Not only you can use Arduino, there are ZigBees, XBs are there, where built-in microcontroller is there along with the ZigBee communication protocol. Like this, in market, you have different sets of combinations are available, where you can use different set of devices to integrate and make use of for your IoT applications for various purposes. So coming to Raspberry Pi 3 or your the latest version 4. So this board is like a mini computer, of course. It has got as a processor. Basically, an ARM processor is there here. So the processor has got its own speed. If you look for the older versions of Raspberry Pi, 900 megahertz. Even with Raspberry Pi 3 also, so many IoT applications have been developed and people are using in the real time too. So Raspberry Pi 4 and so on and so forth, you have 1.1 gigahertz processor, 1.2 gigahertz is also there. Of course, it has got a functionality to connect your HDMIs with the other video devices very easily, the latest Raspberry Pis. So of course, it has got a GPU, the internal processing is also there for the graphics processing. So this graphics processing will enable us to connect very graphical devices like your DVDs or HDMI devices can be easily connected, and the image processing and the graphics processing can be easily done here. So of course, it has got its Bluetooth, Wi-Fi is also there for the Raspberry Pi built-in. Yes, it supports for various USB ports, and the network connectivity is also there. And of course, the camera, computer vision, to do computer vision processing also is there here. So whereas coming to the Arduino, you know, there's the latest versions, RV3. So it has got a processing in the terms of microcontroller is there here. It works with the 5 volts and 3.3 volts with the ground values, as well as the serial and USB converters are there to integrate with the USB devices. So as I mentioned to you, the sensor types, sensors, basically you have a 2-pin sensors or a 3-pin sensors, it obviously differentiates. So 2-pin sensors will not have the voltage divider. Please remember this is fundamentally. Whereas 3-pin sensors will have a voltage divider too.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you, sir.
Yes, sir.
One participant, R. Ashwini, has raised her hand.
Okay. So, yeah. Can you please,
madam, connect to madam, Please, madam, could you please unmute yourself? Yeah, please. Please ask your doubt, madam. You have anything to ask, madam? Any doubt? Or is it done accidentally?
No problem. Still a little bit, some more slides are there. I need to convey something. So let me complete the presentation. I'll give you, there'll be at the end of the session, we can have a discussion, sir. There's no problem. So I give you 10 minutes. So we have another half an hour, is there? So another 10, 15 minutes, I'll wind up. Then the last 15 minutes, you can have a discussion. Yeah. Sure. So basically, the digital sensors, now again, coming to the sensor types, there are two types of sensors, basically analog sensors and digital sensors. So it is obvious that digital sensors will have a conversion which is already inbuilt in that particular digital sensors. Of course, the analog sensors can be of either two pins or three pins. You need to make sure that proper register values and those functionalities are being taken care of. Otherwise, you are going to fire up those sensors or your board. The basic difference between these analog to digital sensors is that the digital sensors will have a certain protocol which has been followed so that those digital values are being properly retrieved and properly processed along with certain libraries. So of course, these protocols are either hardware built in, so they have been embedded or they have been fabricated into that particular hardware device itself. So those protocols are basically your I2C inter-integrated circuits. We call it as I2C or I2C, both are same. And other thing is called the serial peripheral interface, SPI. So in short, we'll see it in a couple of slides. So how do you measure the analog values? So here we are using a voltage divider. In this particular three-pin circuit, the schematic of that particular sensor is, you can see it here. We are giving the voltage divider is there. So the sensor value, instead of that resistor, the sensor is already been embedded together. So we are getting that corresponding. So through Vout, you are going to measure what is the corresponding sensor value you are going to get it from this. So if you are not, if the manufacturer is not following, obviously you will not get, you will get erroneous values, and those values are not appropriate for you to do certain processing. So if you look to a button, most of you people are aware of what is a button. So usually you use a push button. A push button, when you press, something is going to happen. When you just release after pressing, something is going to happen. Basically, the button is, that button is an analog sensor. Please remember that. So this analog sensor, what you do is, if you press, you are going to get a zero current which is going to flow. If you are going to release it, it will be an infinite. And if it is, it's infinite, obviously nothing is going to come out or nothing is going to be shocked for you. So that is the basic principle here. And you will use the, mostly the sensor of a potentiometer. Sensor is not, of course, it's not a sensor. It's a variable resistance. We can call it in another way. You are going to adjust your resistance value when you're connecting to a particular sensor. So you can make use of this potentiometer if you are not sure how the sensor is going to give its corresponding outputs properly. So basically, when you use the sensors of flexible sensors, flexible means pressure sensors. Basically, you use a pressure sensor, you don't know, you need to adjust the pressure sensors when you connect with certain objects. So at what resistance those particular pressure sensors use the output, you don't know. So that you need to make sure a potentiometer is being connected to that flexi sensors or your pressure sensors, so that you'll get the appropriate outputs. So whenever there's certain pressure is there on that sensors to monitor it. So the, in that way, the potentiometers are going to be widely used. Of course, this can be used for your light sensors or to illuminate the light or to glow the light and other set of things. So if you can, this potentiometer is also going to have inbuilt, that is the voltage divider. That is what the variable resistance. If you can see, there's the same voltage divider, but with the variable resistance of R1 and R2, you can change those either in the R1 at the R2 level. Logically, you can see it on the diagram that you, with a screwdriver, you can change the knob to a different direction. You can adjust that particular resistor values. Temperature sensor, basically TLM35 is an analog sensor. Usually you measure the ambient temperature. Ambient means the environmental temperature here. So once you get that particular V measured, the output of this ambient, you need to convert it, because you are using ADC value, that is the ADC microcontroller converts that particular analog to your digital. And once you use that digital value, again, you are going to have a conversion family, conversion formula to get the appropriate centigrade or appropriate Fahrenheit. So you can use it that 1023 is the base factor for this. So for the get the appropriate values, which have been measured from the analog and it is converted to the digital. And you also have a gas sensor here. A gas sensor, basically you can see there is a 4-pin MQ3, MQ2, MQ120 and so on. So different types of gases like alkaline, methane, other LPG gases at your homes. If you want to measure, you have a gas sensor, which will be of different numbers. You need to look into that, what type of sensor gas you are going to monitor. You can see that particular set of pins. So here you have 3 pins or your 4 pins, depending on that. You can see one pin will be VCC, one pin will be the output that is coming from that particular gaseous sensor, and one pin will be the ground. So if you look to the digital sensors, as I mentioned just now, it uses two different set of protocols. One is a serial peripheral interface, and other is a inter-integrated circuit, I2C. So this inter-integrated circuit is basically a bus which can connect multiple devices, and there will be one master, that is I2C master, which controls several devices which are connected to your board. So that is the digital values can be easily collected from different devices which are acting like a slaves. So this particular devices can be managed and can be controlled with the signals of a serial data line and with the serial clock line signals. Of course, the data rate or your the speed at which this particular I2C bus functions is of compared to your SPI is very less only. It usually follows 100 kilobits of information in terms of bytes of information that needs to be transferred. Of course, the different mode, in the latest one, you have a 3.4 megabits of data transfer, which is happens at a time when you collect the data from multiple different types of sensors. You need to collect the data at a time or one after the other simultaneously. With the help of master slave configuration, you can make use of this one. Similarly, the serial peripheral interface, which is a better version, which is having higher speed than your I2C. So usually we use it for your digital data to be collected. So they can work either in the master out slave in phase or your master in slave out phases. So you can set the appropriate clocks to interface with the different set of slave devices or different set of sensors which are acting like a slaves at this particular point of application. So SPI and I2C are going to be widely used if you are going to have a real-time applications like smart transportation, as I mentioned to you, if you are collecting the different data. So your circuit definitely should be more or less having the SPIs and I2C configurations very easily, and it should be adaptable. So as far as this microcontrollers and computers are concerned, both the SPIs and I2C are going to be widely used for your digital sensors. So if you see the various peripherals like your sound buzzers or your LCD displays or your push buttons, so you have a different set of your digital, these are all your digital devices which can be made use to connect to various Raspberry Pis and as well as your Arduino boards for interfacing with various sensors. So already I mentioned to you this LED, which is basically a diode, which has on only anode and cathode. That's why you're having one more resistor here. So this particular LED glows with having a voltage of more than 0.6 volts. So you have an infrared resistance up to 0.6 volts only, and zero resistance when it lights up, because this is just an LED. It is not your ordinary bulb. So in an ordinary bulb, you'll have a resistor, whereas LEDs doesn't have a resistors here. So for that, you are going to have this resistor value so that you can control the flow of current here. So I would like to share some of those, whatever the things that I have discussed here. With that discuss, I was, as part of my PhD study, as well as my doctoral study, I was involved in designing and developing various sensors here. So if you can see this, I forgot to bring that box. It is in another room. So now, tomorrow session, I'll show you the one, the box which you are seeing on that figure. I have brought it. Go to my in my bag, there is a box. I'll just bring that box here and I can show you physically here. It is there in our lab. So what is this box is? These are your sensing systems. So that box, whatever you see here, black boxes here, which is connected to a room heater, as well as your toaster, your microwave. You can see a chair. Below the chair, there is one more box here. So a old lady is sleeping on a bed, and you have a box is connected to your television, and a box here you can see there is a, of course it's not a black box, but you can see a gray box which is connected to a sewing machine. And of course you can see the box is connected to the couch. There's your sofa at the bottom of this. So what is this boxes are all? Basically you are, whatever the, these are the smart sensors which are been designed, developed indigenously at the lab where I've studied. And those particular systems are deployed on the real systems in the sense that in the real home environment, with the real objects, and you collect those data. You can see on the right side of the figure, there is a coordinator, which is a laptop, which is help of a Zigbee coordinator. All the data which has been made use of from these objects are being collected. So basically, as far as the software setup is concerned, these are the software tools which I used it. As far apart from the sensor systems, you can use multiple houses are connected here, and you are able to collect the data. And of course, your artificial intelligence. And yeah, so that, this is the box actually. That's what I was trying to show you. I can just open it and I can show you the circuit also here. And you can do the machine learning and artificial intelligence techniques for various purposes, like open them. Screws are there. So like this one human emotion recognition also we are developed here. Of course, all this philosophy in developing the smart sensing systems is basically through whatever the fundamentals I have described to you and presented here, with these sensors only and with these gadgets only. So nothing new here, just a circuit diagram is the only new things for these particular sets of things. So if you see here, this is the electrical sensing unit. On the figure you can see here, two electrical devices can be connected to the same box. So you have a direct connection to your 220 volts. That's why you have put a transformer to make your 220 volts, and you have a circuit here to bring down your conversion from 220 volts to your 3.3 volts. So that's 3.3 volts. And also you have a wireless communication medium. That's what you can see it here in this diagram. So what, of course it may not be clear, but this is there in the lab. So this is what I can just plug it on. If you're not clear, I can show you later. So yeah, so here, basically the idea is, what you need to understand is, if you see the circuit diagram, it is a simple basic circuit diagrams here with the resistors, with the microcontrollers, and with your XBs, and with your just a transformers and all. And you are able to connect them. Only thing is you need to make the circuits. Of course, the circuit diagram is available on this paper which you have published. So this is a smart power management. And all these works have been already published works. And I can, if you see the citations for these published works, you can search on the Google Scholar. For all these papers which have been published in 2012, 2014, 2016 and all, you can see the people are still referring to this. So this is another medical dispensing unit, which is also with the Zigbee protocol. The same circuit is there to give the tablets. So all these are working with the same wireless communication media and the circuits here. So to these smart sensing systems is not very very strange or a very complex task. It is just a simple basics which you need to do, and you need to connect the systems. So at the laboratory level itself, you can design and develop. Of course, the things have been published and some of them are been commercialized too. So that is one thing that you need to make an understanding here. So let me just tell you what are the key open issues of the IoT. What are the issues, the research issues and the development side issues. So the architecture itself, each manufacturer has given a different set of architectures. The servers are different. Each one is following their own discovery services, the applications, of course, the security and privacy is the most important things that needs to be taken care for preserving the identity of the persons or the things and so on and so forth. So here, different spectrums of computer networks have been considered here. People use differently. So as such, the standards are not been still. IEEE standards are now coming into existence for various purposes. So if you look to this diagram, you may understand what type of problem that you're going to oversee when you're using Internet of Things. See, even when you say Internet of Things, obviously those things or those objects, the smart objects, are to be connected with various wires and cables and so on and so forth. So of course, all these things can be minimized if you are constructing a new home. Nowadays, you see the smart homes are coming into picture. Of course, the smart word is there, but not of all the things are smart here. Only some of the things, some things are automated. They say the smart things. But it takes a lot of cost involved in setting up smart things and all. It is a huge cost. So the challenges in IoT is internet, availability of internet. That's why the fog computing, edge computing have come. They have taken their place to overcome the cloud computings and to connect the remote places. So acceptability among the society and the individuals, yes, when you deploy a system, not all people will accept it, and they don't want, because they see that the privacy is being lost, or they see that the things are something is not secured and all. So obviously these things are to be now taken care of. So low cost, of course, the smart sensors, low cost is very, very much required for the affordability of a common man. So that is the most important thing we need to look for. And of course, the energy harvesting, because the smart sensing systems require a lot of energy, in the sense that it has to run for days or months or years. So if you put a Raspberry Pi system, and if you have a certain battery for this Raspberry Pi system, then obviously if you are, it can consume a lot of energy. If you use an Arduino board, obviously it consumes less energy and it can run for a longer period of time. That is also another advantage of Arduino boards here. But of course, there is a small limitations on the Arduino boards too. So computational ability, nowadays people are now producing different resource constrained computing devices that are very much widely available, low cost devices, scalability, you can increase more number of devices and they are been reliable, they are functioning properly, they have been working together. Fault tolerance, yes. Of course, they're all still the research issues itself. People are giving their own ideas. A lot of publications are coming. Of course, the industry also is working very hard. Very, so many other issues are also been existing. So the future challenge will be a smart sensing. Always you make sure that the smart sensor consists of your wireless communication media with the antennas. The smart sensors are already embedded with the intelligent programs. A low power electronics, which will always power your system for a longer duration of time. And a photovoltaic cells, of course, you can not only photovoltaic, you can go for other set of substrates too for a longer duration of your power supplies. So you can see the IoT standards now. The IoT standards are getting evolved. IEEE standards are coming into picture. People are working on this. So in future, you can see how things can be easily connected by following the standards, what they have been governing us. So now it's almost 13:12. Yes, now I stop for the question answer sessions, please. I'm just opening the chat window. Can you hold on? Question is coming to the chat window. So please share session one MCQ and feedback link. I think the feedback link.
It is shared, sir.
It is shared already. Done. Yes. Vin voltage input. Vin stands for voltage input. That the voltage that you are going to give it to your sensing system. So Vin, or some people say VCC, is a common term which you use it here. So, sir, can't we use Raspberry for hard real-time systems? Raspberry Pi alone cannot be used. That's what my experience says. Because when you are going to monitor the ambient environment, in the sense that environmental parameters are getting monitored, so Raspberry Pi, for real-time, it's going to take some time alone. So you have to augment the Raspberry Pi with any other microcontroller, which you need to speed up the things. So real time, so Raspberry Pi is not good when latency time is less. Yes, it depends on the application, the latency time, how much is the tolerable one, how much is the affordable one for you. So if you are in the sense that critical applications for critical things, obviously that's what your Arduino, if you can directly embed your code onto your, you can directly interact with your hardware, that is always preferable. And on that hardware, nowadays your artificial intelligence and machine learning algorithms are able to be done. So that is the stage at which the people are doing a lot of explorations, a lot of academic research is going on. If you see, many of the universities are now trying to deploy your AI and machine learning algorithms onto your edge computing. That's what edge computing is focused upon for the last 2 years. And it is in still much progress is going on. So yeah, that is one. I'm just looking for question by question here. Is Raspberry Pi feasible in all cases? See, there for industrial applications, no. For at least for research outcomes, yes. At least to explore. So yeah, for you, when you are exploring and when you are trying to find out a new set of things, so always the Raspberry Pi is going to be an advantage because you can program it and you can play with this and you can try to optimize the things and you can run the things according to your logic and you can minimize this. Just hold on, please, 1 second. Yeah. So I'm just coming question by question here. Sir, DSR, day one zip file needs access token. Please give access. I have already sent this particular day one zip file. Are you still having some issues in downloading those? Please kindly check. Mail has been sent to your Google email. So attendance link, through Zoom, we are able to collect your attendances, please. We are not separately taking the attendances. The duration of your presence in the Zoom will definitely inform us about your attendance there. So you need not worry about this attendance link through Google Forms. Feedback is again sent to your emails, please. Feedback for session one is already sent. Sir, is Raspberry feasible in all cases? Yes, as I told you, Raspberry Pi is going to be a kind of a platform will be help you to realize and write your own programs and deploy your own programs and test it. Later you can, need not when you have think that you are testing your validations and everything has been working fine, you can just replace Raspberry Pi with your microcontroller and so on and so forth. Can a 64-bit system can be used for better performance? Yes, of course. Now Raspberry Pi 64-bit systems are coming now. The latest one, Raspberry Pi 4, do support 64-bit operating system. It is a better one mostly. Performances are increasing. Yes, hardware costs are coming down and performances are increasing. So if you see Raspberry Pi is doing very fast advancements in the last 2 years. So you definitely will see a good involvement, and people do work very wisely here. Suppose I want to control the access permission for the confidential data. It is possible. If I understood your question correctly, Hemagara, I want to control the access permission for the confidential data. Yes, it all depends on the mechanism that you incorporate in accessing the data. Say, if you want to put some security measures, or if you want to use a lightweight protocols for your transmission in the data and to keep your data safe. Yes, we do it, and we are doing those things only. People are doing much works on this particular area. And coming to for agriculture application, which one should be good, Raspberry Pi or Arduino? See, if you are Raspberry Pi, it can be used at a gateway level. When I say gateway level, if you have a network of sensing systems, when I say a sensor with along with certain instrumentation, and they have been interconnected with each other. So a set of sensing systems forms a network, and that network usually will have a gateway. So Raspberry Pi can be easily placed. That's what my experience tells me. The Raspberry Pi can be acting like a gateway for those interconnected communication systems. So it can gather, it can have the sensor fusion. The sensor fusion means the fusion, you collect the data from various sensors and you process it at that particular Raspberry Pi level or at the gateway level. So like a coordinated manner, you can do it. That is one way. Depending on your application, if you want to process the data at the sensor level only, you can do through Arduino programming too. So you need not go it. If you have a wide area to be monitored, so your monitoring area is very large, and if you want to go for a large scale and you want to have a feasibility for your application, then you can go with the Raspberry Pi as well as with the audio combination of these two. ZigBee protocol used for indoor? Yes, basically ZigBee 2.4 gigahertz. Basically, it is a very reliable protocol. When compared to Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, most of your IoT applications do use ZigBee protocol. It has its own set of communication standard, IEEE 802.15.4. So this protocol, when you are internal, like smart homes, smart buildings, so and your interior places, definitely ZigBee protocol is the most preferable one rather than for your Wi-Fi or LoRa. So when you want to go for a long distance monitoring, obviously you go for a LoRa. So one of my students is also doing on this LoRa TTGO. This is called as mesh static. So he will explain to you on the day 4. We'll plan it for your LoRa for monitoring remote distances. Connecting remotely without your infrastructure, without your telephone connection. So that is what the mesh static is basically. So when you go for outdoor, if you want to monitor kilometers, if your monitoring area is in terms of kilometers, then LoRa is most preferable. Otherwise, for indoors, ZigBee protocol is enough for us. Because ZigBee is more reliable than your Wi-Fi or your Bluetooth. When I say reliable, your data is not going to be lost. And of course, I'll get back to that, because all the sensing devices which we have developed is basically the ZigBee protocol only, using XB. XB is the company, DG company manufactures those XB devices. I can show you it in the afternoon session sometime later. So, okay, apart from C, what program lines can we use, run Arduino and Raspberry Pi? See, Raspberry Pi, as I mentioned, basically a wide variety of softwares can be used on the Raspberry Pi. You can use Python for your data processing and data analysis on Raspberry Pi. You can use C itself. You can use your Visual Programming. You can use your JavaScripts. So today, tomorrow, I'll show you the JavaScripts, how we are going to be run on using your Node.js servers and all, because people always believe that only Python is the only programming language which will help us for IoT. It's not like that. There are other programming languages also there, like your JavaScript, which can be usable. It can be used on your embedded systems very easily and very flexibly. So the advantages are there. when you go for a browser-based and other set of applications. So I'll come in your sessions, we'll come to know what are the differences in different programming languages too. But Arduino, basically Arduino supports your C programming, the hardware level programming is hardware compatible. So your Arduino is directly interacting with your hardware. So your hardware compatibility is basically your C. So here, there are only emulators and simulators are there, which are going to be used for different purposes. But Arduino, you go for only for C. How can we use Raspberry Pi in VANETs? See, your ad hoc networks, you can, whenever there is only data transmission, you can make use of that Raspberry Pi to collect the data or to have the sensor fusion. Otherwise, no need to collect all the times here. For your, if you are going for the smart transportations, when there is no movements or there's no need to data collect, you need not use it. You have to reprogram it, that's all. That's the most important things. In robotics also, you can interact with machine to machine. So you can make use of those as a gateways here, basically. Do we need a new, new network protocols for IoT? The communication purpose in the IoT devices, what happens is the communication itself, it takes a lot of bandwidth and a lot of time, then the real-time processing of data doesn't happen when you have a machine-to-machine interaction. See, in IoT, one device is going to talk with another device, or a set of devices do coordinate themselves to realize a certain application. So the sensing systems and all, they like to coordinate with them very easily. So the network protocols, like your HTTP, your HTTPs and all those, your web browsing tech protocols will not be sufficient. So that's why MQTT and COAP has come, but MQTT and COAP, the security and privacy issues are there here. For MQTT and COAP of networking protocols. So we need to look for how best we can incorporate the security and privacy mechanisms on that particular lightweight communication media. PHP support. See, PHP is only basically a scripting language which will enable you to design and develop your graphical user interfaces or your interactive systems with the system, interactive systems. Means you want to interact with the hardware device with a GUI. Obviously, you can use a programming language. It need not be a PHP. It can be done by using Python, or it can be using your C++ also. You can see also you can do it. What preparation is required for your practice session? See, preparation as such, we will try to inform you and you'll tell the steps to be done. So this practice session is for those beginners. Beginners is a must. So for an expert, obviously you can look for the second day practice and all. So for the beginners, please do attend the practice session. It will give you some kind of insights on collecting the data and processing it. Yeah. Any other doubts, please? Yeah, thank you for
sir,
all.
Before we close the session, participants are requested to give their feedback on session 2, and we will share the link to session 3 in WhatsApp group as well as through Google group. Thank you. Once you give the feedback, you can exit the session. We share the link to session 3 in WhatsApp group as well as Gmail in the Google group. Thank you. I'm raising the poll. Please give your feedback. Feedback form is in progress. Feedback is in progress. I think we can give your feedback. Thank you for the feedback. I will close the session, and the next session starts at 2:30. I will share the link to session 3 in the group, both WhatsApp group as well as mail, the Google group also. Thank you.